right. Well, good morning, everyone. I hate to interrupt everyone's conversations, but the timer, it requires me to start on time. So good morning, and a special welcome to you also if you're watching online. If you are new and you don't know who I am, my name is Nathan Drover, and I am the lead pastor here at Perth-Andover Baptist Church. And I am just really thrilled and excited to be gathered here to worship God with you all this morning. For our call to worship, I want to read out from Psalm 46. This is a very common psalm. With everything going on in the world around us, at times we can feel like there's a lot of chaos, a lot of uncertainty. And here is the picture that the psalmist of Psalm 46 gives us of God. He says, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling." This picture of God as our refuge and strength and our rock, I hope we can take comfort in that this morning as we come to worship Him together. So let's pray before we move into a time of musical worship. Father, I thank you that no matter what is going on around us, whether it's chaos and turmoil or whatever is happening, we just turn to you now to be our rock, our refuge, and strength. God, give us a sense of rootedness, a sense of peace, a sense of calm and comfort as we come into your presence to worship you for what you've done and accomplished through Jesus Christ and the way that you have saved us in him. So God, we thank you for this work, and we pray that you would pour out your spirit and be present with us now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Right, as we move out of the Easter season, which is always this really joyful celebration of worship, I feel like sometimes it can feel hard to know where we're going. So what I would invite you to do is stand with us, and we're going to sing through the whole story, the story that started at the beginning of time. It goes through Christmas, through Easter, and remember that it doesn't stop there. The story continues into Pentecost and the Spirit coming, and then all the way here to us today and His church. So let's sing King of Kings.
Light, till from heaven you came running. There
stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death,
and the dead was from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who would come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame, now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not hate, by His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free, in the blood of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Oh, praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. Oh, praise forever to the King of Kings.
All right, and you can stay standing, but our kids are invited to come up for our kids' song to celebrate what an awesome God we have. With wisdom, power, and love. There we go. We got it.
Yeah. Here we go. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. From heaven above with wisdom, power, and love, our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love, our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above.
Good morning, everyone. At this time, we'll take up our morning tithes and offerings for those who don't take advantage of giving online. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day you've given us and this opportunity to give back a small portion of what you've so richly blessed us with. At this time, we ask you to give blessings to those who give and to the gifts that we're about to receive. We thank you in Jesus' name, amen. Just birthday announcements. Today is Pam Warman's birthday, but she tells me she doesn't celebrate anymore since she turned 60. So don't say happy birthday to Pam today. And on Saturday, Mary Hollins has a birthday. So happy birthday to all those that are celebrating this week. I'll just touch on a few announcements. The rest of them you can read for yourself in the bulletin. Youth group tonight here at the church at 6:30. And tomorrow night, the River Kids Youth meet here at the church at 6 o'clock.
Not tomorrow.
Not tomorrow? Sorry, the 24th. So not tomorrow, but the 24th. Prayer walk is on Tuesday here at the church, or at the Civic Center, rather, at 1:30 every Tuesday. And men's coffee hour here Wednesday at 10 o'clock here at the church. And just an announcement for a church business meeting is coming up April the 30th. And we need to vote on a Northwest Association delegate. So just keep that in mind on April 30th. If you're interested in being a delegate, let Pastor Nathan know. So that'll be just a short business meeting on the 30th. That's all I have.
Before we go to prayer, Cameron didn't talk about the pickleball tournament. And it's for Camp Schicktohawk. So all money raised goes to Camp Schicktohawk. But the very important thing is that as a church, we need to raise money, or the groups that go are going to have to play with oven mitts on and choir robes. And I don't know what all they've got made up, but we need some support. So it'd be really good if you could do that and remember that all money goes to Camp Schicktohawk. So now we're going to go into prayer for the prayers of the people. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for these wonderful spring temperatures that we've been enjoying and for the melting snow. And Lord, we, as we look at our river and we see the ice flowing, we're thankful, God, that the ice is flowing. And we pray, Lord, for a continued safety here in our village from flooding. Lord, I want to give you thanks for our pastors, Pastor Nathan and Sabrina, and for Pastor Sheila. And Lord, we pray for your Holy Spirit to guide them as they minister to this church. We pray to you for you to work also in people's hearts so they'll want to deepen their relationship to you. And we pray that they'll join Pastor Nathan in the growing deeper group that he's going to do. God, we pray also for our children and youth of our church and of our community. We thank you for Kat and Sabrina for working hard to bring the visions of all the programs forward. And we also pray, God, and give thanks for the volunteers to help to make these programs happen and for the children, the youth who attend. We pray, God, especially for our coming VBS program. We pray, God, that you will see that this program goes through in a positive way and that we'll engage people to help with all the different activities that are involved with VBS. And we pray, God, just to have a successful program, that it will touch many children's lives and that we can share the love of Jesus with them. And Lord, now our prayer is for those who are sick, all who are dealing with physical pain, with aging bodies, for those who are dealing with cancer and its treatments, for those who are dealing with long-term illness, for those who are waiting for surgeries, for those who find their happiness through addictions, for those who feel lost and alone, not knowing that you are the one to bring them peace and to give them hope. We pray for those whose hearts are heavy with grief, who are struggling to live in a world that has changed in a blink of an eye. And we pray for those who do not know you. Lord, I pray this prayer. Almighty Yahweh, you are the source of health and healing. In you we find calmness and true peace. Grant to each of your children who are hurting an awareness of your presence in our daily lives, and give us confidence to trust in you, in your love for us. in all our pain, anxiety, and weariness. Teach us to give ourselves over to your never-failing care. Help us to truly believe that your love and power surrounds us daily, every moment. Help us to trust in your wisdom and to renew our health and strength and peace, all in your time. Mostly, dear Father, teach us to turn to you to ask for help instead of depending on ourselves or the strength of this world. And Lord, I ask you to bless each person here today. May we, your servants, allow your love to shine through us in our families and in our community today, every day. Amen.
Just got to quickly do a Bible swap here. All right, there we go. Yes, yeah. I couldn't help but laugh when Tanya was like, "You forgot the pickleball tournament." So we've got some big pickleball fans, in case you don't know, in this church. But it's a lot of fun. I'm looking forward to it. I'm going to be going, and I'm going to win. No, probably not. I don't know. But it will be fun regardless. So we're at a time now in the point of our service where we are going to turn to God's Word to see what it has to say to us and how it might form us to be faithful to God as His people in our world today. And so just before we do that, I know Tanya just prayed, but I'd like to pray for us again. So let's just quickly pray. Father, I want to thank you for your word and your spirit who you have given to us as a down payment, so to speak, of our inheritance when we placed our faith in Jesus Christ. As we turn to the Bible to see what it has to say to us now, I just pray that you would plant these words in our hearts, that they would flourish there and bear fruit in our lives. Use this time to form us as your people. We pray these things in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. So if you know me, then you probably know that I enjoy reading a lot of nonfiction books about Christian theology, beliefs, the Bible, all that stuff. And a few weeks ago, Sabrina and I were down to the Christian bookstore called The Lighthouse in Fredericton, and she let me wander off for a moment. She found out that was a bit of a mistake. I think in about the span of a couple minutes, I came back with 7 or 8 books I was just ready to buy. But I didn't always actually like reading. In fact, as a kid, you can probably count the number of book series that I read books from on 1, maybe 2 hands. I just really was not that into reading books. But of the handful of book series that I did read from, one of them was aimed at Christian teens. And unfortunately, I can't remember the name of this series, but the books revolved around spiritual warfare. So let me give you just a brief general outline of a typical plot from this book series as far as I can remember it now. The main characters were a group of teenagers, and many of them were Christian, but not all of them. And so typically one of the non-Christian teens or one of their teachers or someone they know would get involved in something spiritually dark. So for example, in one book, I believe one of the friends decided to start using an Ouija board, and well, the plot took off from there. Strange things started happening. Eventually, demons get involved. And at the climax of the story, the teens and or the Christian adults confront the demon. And these confrontations were similar to what you might have seen in movies today. The possessed person's voice changes. They have supernatural knowledge, and things might even fly across the room. But the Christians fight back. They quote scripture, they pray prayers, they use holy water and various other holy items. And eventually, after, you know, a long battle of back and forth and all of these types of things, Christians emerge victorious, and the demon is cast out, and then the book comes to an end. Now, when we hear the words spiritual warfare, it's likely that we have something like this story in mind. Spiritual warfare, we might think, is all about trying to cast out demons. So spiritual warfare, in other words, is the same thing as performing exorcisms. And because most of us have never done this, I'm assuming, I never have, we might assume that we don't engage in spiritual warfare at all. We might think that casting out demons is something that happens in, you know, Africa or Asia, but it's not something we're really involved with here. And if spiritual warfare is like what we see on TV and read in books, we probably wouldn't even want to be engaged in it. I mean, to fight a spiritual battle like that sounds pretty scary. It seems like it would take a lot of knowledge and training, and so it's not something we would even really be able to do. In my own life and in conversations with others, I've found that this is the general picture people have when they hear the words spiritual warfare. But I'm going to suggest this morning that there's a problem with this picture. While I believe that there's truth in it, this picture produces three false ideas or myths about spiritual warfare. And those myths are what I'm going to try to correct and talk about today. But before we get to those, let me introduce our new sermon series. If you were with us back in the fall of 2022, you would know that we did a series then called Spirit-Led, Living by God's Power. And in that series, we looked at the book of Acts. And the book of Acts, if I could summarize it in a sentence, it would be that the book of Acts is trying to tell us the story of God's continuing mission through the church. And so in Acts, we saw how God empowers his people to proclaim the good news that Jesus is king. As they do, we saw how God stretched out his hand to perform signs and wonders through them. And we saw that the promise of God's Spirit and his leading is for us today as well. So over the next few months, we're actually going to kind of pick up back in that series and build on that foundation. We're going to look at the ways that the Holy Spirit gives us special gifts, or you might have heard them referred to as spiritual gifts. We're going to talk about spiritual gifts and what they are, why the Holy Spirit gives them to us, and what we should do with them. But today we're going to start off this series by talking about spiritual warfare. So we're going to kind of cover the two hot topics of the Spirit in the church, right? Spiritual warfare and spiritual gifts. And the reason that we're going to start off with this topic of spiritual warfare is because whether you know it or not, there are spiritual battles happening all around you. And I want you to be ready to engage in them and fight in them. So in order to do that, we're going to begin by looking at Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 18. And as we do, we'll go along and try to correct the three big myths that people often believe about spiritual warfare. So with that being said, if you have your Bibles with you, you can turn with me to Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 18. This is the end part of the letter that the Apostle Paul has written to the church in Ephesus. And so as we've started doing recently, I'm going to read this passage out twice. The first time I'm going to read it from the First Nations version, and then the second time I'll read it from the NIV, and the words for both should also be up on the screen. So let's start with Ephesians 6, from the 6 verse 10 forward from the First Nations version. So here's how they translate it. Last of all, I must remind you that we are all fighting in a spiritual battle. We are weak human beings, so let your strength come from our great warrior chief. The only way to stand strong against the war plans of the evil trickster is to put on the Creator's war garments. But remember, we are not fighting against human beings. Our battle is against the evil rulers, the dark powers, and the spiritual forces of the spirit world above and around us. Once you are fully dressed for this war, you will be able to stand your ground on this day of the enemy's evil rule. You are now ready to make your stand, so stand strong. Wrap the sash of truth around your waist. Cover your heart with the breastplate of making wrongs right again. Put on your feet the, I don't know how to pronounce that word, mochazins of Creator's peace treaty. So you will always be ready to tell the good story as you walk the road of life. Then you must raise high the shield of trusting in the Creator. The shield will put out the flaming arrows of the evil one. Do not forget to put on the headdress of Creator's power to rescue and set free. And use the long knife of the Spirit, which is the word of Creator coming from your mouth. All of this is done by prayer, sending your voice to the Great Spirit, asking Him for all that is needed. As you pray with the help of the Spirit, stay alert and keep all of the Creator's holy people in your thoughts, praying for their needs. And next I'll read from Ephesians 6, verses 10 to 18, from the NIV. Let me just find it here. It says, "Finally be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm, then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all of this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people." Okay. So as I explained before, before the reading of Ephesians, there's a pretty common picture of what spiritual warfare looks like. From fictional stories aimed at Christian teens to mainstream Hollywood movies, spiritual warfare is portrayed as casting out demons with crucifixes and holy water. But as I said, this picture of spiritual warfare presents us with three big myths. And so here's the first myth that I want to tackle this morning. Spiritual warfare is all about casting out demons. Now, right away, I want to make a clarification to make sure that you don't misunderstand me. I'm not denying that demons exist or that they aren't an enemy in spiritual warfare. And if you want to talk to me more about that after, I'd be happy to do that. But what I am saying is that spiritual warfare is much bigger than that. We're not only fighting against demons. In fact, I would say that most of us may never even do that. But we are still in the middle of a spiritual war against evil powers. The key verse we need to focus on to correct this myth is Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. Paul writes, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms." So Paul begins by making it crystal clear who our battle is not against. We are not fighting a physical battle against other people. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, and so people are not our enemy. Instead, Paul tells us that our spiritual battle is against the rulers, the authorities, the powers of this dark world, and the spiritual forces of evil. And so right off the bat, we can make a pretty key observation here. Paul doesn't use the word demon in this list. Instead, his language is much broader, referring to things like the world powers of this darkness and spiritual forces of evil. These terms can include demons, but the main point here is that they also include more. Let's just focus in on one of these for a moment. The third thing that Paul says we are against, if we were translating it really literally, would be something like the world powers of this darkness. When Paul uses the image of darkness, he's drawing on imagery that he's already talked about earlier in the letter. Darkness in Ephesians 5 is a way of describing the state of the world without God. Living in this darkness, it produces fruitless deeds that ultimately lead to shame. By contrast, Paul talks about those who live in the light, meaning living in goodness and righteousness and truth. And so to put it simply, in the rest of the letter, darkness is the realm of sin and shame in the world. And so with that background in mind, come back to you Ephesians 6:12 with me. When Paul says that we are against the world powers of this darkness, he's talking about more than demons. He's talking about all the powers that promote darkness in our world. And so he's talking about things like sin and shame. So again, just to reiterate my point in all of this, spiritual warfare is not just a battle against demons. Spiritual warfare is a battle against all evil spiritual forces, whether they're personal, like demons, or impersonal, like sin. Spiritual warfare is a battle against all spiritual forces that exert influence over and have power in this world. So let me give you an example of what I mean. Racism would be an evil force that has power in our world. And as an evil power, the Christian church must engage in spiritual warfare against it. Let me be pretty concrete with this example. Many of us are probably familiar with the Rwandan genocide. In 1994, 500,000 to 800,000 Tutsi people were killed by Hutu gangs, soldiers, and citizens. The year before the genocide, the Hutu power group believed that the national radio station had become too liberal, and so they formed their own radio station It has a French name, I think, but we'll just call it the RTLM, as it came to be known as. So before the genocide began, this new radio station, which was very popular, started promoting anti-Tutsi propaganda. They described the Tutsi people as a dangerous enemy and a threat. It dehumanized them, referring to them as pests and cockroaches, which need to be exterminated. To quote one broadcast, it said, just to give you an idea of what it would be like, someone must make them disappear for good, to wipe them from human memory, to exterminate the Tutsi from the surface of the earth. Now, here's my point in all of this. These broadcasts are not spiritually neutral. They had an undeniable and direct impact on the violence of the Rwandan genocide. And they were a scheme of the devil. And the racism inherent to them is a power of this world's darkness. And so the church cannot stand by when evil powers such as racism rear their heads. We shouldn't be fooled into thinking that just because there wasn't a demon in the radio station, that dark spiritual forces were not at work. Racism and hatred are powerful forces for evil in this world, and the church must stand against them. Now, we're about to move on to our second myth, which won't take us as long to correct as this first myth, as long as we understand this first one. And because this first one is so important, I'm going to reiterate my point again, even though you're probably tired of hearing it, which is that spiritual warfare is broader than demonic exorcisms. It involves engaging with any and every spiritual power around us, including powers like racism and other sin. Okay, so the second myth, the reason why I emphasize the first one so much is because the second myth really flows out of the first one. And here it is. Very few of us, if any of us, have tried to cast out a demon out of anyone, of course. And so this leads us to believe in the second myth that we aren't engaged in spiritual warfare. So I want us to think about the implications of this myth and belief for a moment. Imagine we were in a literal war. Perth-Andover is under siege, and there are enemy soldiers going through the streets to attack and destroy us. And now imagine all that's going on, but we're living as if life is perfectly normal, and no one is attacking us. Things wouldn't go very well for us. And yet, when it comes to spiritual warfare, many of us live as if we're not engaged in it. But the battles are going on all around us. So in response to this second myth, we can see that Paul certainly believes that there is a war going on. In verse 11, Paul says, "Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes." And down in verse 16, he says, "We need to take up the shield of faith with which we can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one." So Paul isn't telling us to put on God's battle gear here because it's fashionable. He's telling us to do it because there are evil powers working around us. We need to take up our shields because there are flaming arrows that need to be extinguished. And all of this makes a bit more sense if we remember what we said about myth number one. When we remember that spiritual warfare is not, or at least it's more than casting out demons. When we recognize that spiritual warfare is about engaging with spiritual powers like racism, hatred and shame and greed, evil political structures even, and so on, then we can see that spiritual warfare is happening all around us. Now, before we move on to our final myth, I want to talk about verse 13 for a second, because that might confuse some of us if we were reading it really closely. A straightforward translation of this verse would be something like, "Because of this, take up the full armor of God in order that you might resist in the evil day." And based on this verse, some people get the impression that the evil day is someday in the future, and so we're not engaged in spiritual warfare now. We're preparing for it, and we will engage with it someday in the future. But once again, it's helpful to remember that Ephesians chapter 6 is coming at the end of a letter that Paul has written. And if we had read through the entire letter, then we would actually already know what the evil day is, because Paul has already talked about them. In Ephesians 5, 15 and 16, Paul says, "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil." And so when Paul talks about the evil day in our passage, he's talking about our lives now. There will be days that are more intense than others, but he commands us to put on God's armor and to stand now. And he commands us to do that because fiery arrows are being shot now, because you're in the battlefield now, and we need to be ready. I mean, this isn't hard to see, right? Like, just look at the world around us for a moment. Just based on what I hear from the teens in the youth group, there is racism and sexism in the schools. Another example would be something like addiction and how its shame holds power over numerous people who we might know and love. And selfishness can be found in almost every person's heart, including our own. Now again, just because this is so often conflated, I want to make a clarifying statement, especially around the addiction and selfishness piece. I'm not saying that people who are addicted are possessed by demons or something like that. I hope that's clear by this point. I'm trying to emphasize that for this very reason. It's that these things have power over people, and they keep them trapped. You know, addiction or even like racism typically isn't something that people can just snap out of, right? And that's what I mean. And so we should engage in spiritual warfare over these powers. I hope that's clear. And so, to conclude this myth, while these words are added in the First Nations version translation, I think they get what Paul is saying exactly right. They have him saying, "Last of all, I remind you that we are all fighting in a spiritual battle." And so this leads to our third myth. As I said, in books and in movies, people often use spiritual objects to cast out demons. Objects most commonly like crucifixes and holy water. And so we might think that there are like these special weapons that we need to carry around, or special words that we need to learn in order to fight spiritual war. But that, in my view, is the third myth. The third myth is that spiritual warfare involves having special knowledge or special objects or techniques to battle evil spiritual forces. And the reason that I think this is a myth is because when Paul describes God's battle gear in Ephesians 6, he doesn't talk about holy water. He doesn't give the Ephesian Christians a special set of words to say if they do encounter a demon. Instead, he talks about things like truth. In verse 14, Paul writes, "Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist." And so let's just pause on this one for a moment. How often does evil have a hold in our lives because we believe lies? For example, maybe we believe the lie that we're unworthy of love and worthless. And as a result of this lie, people, and maybe you, are submitting yourselves to internalized shame, and you accept harmful behavior from others who tear you down because you believe that you're not worth anything more. But the truth is that God loves you. You are not worthless or worth less than others. Jesus himself died for you. You are not deserving of harmful behavior from others. Or maybe there's a different lie you believe. Maybe we believe that we're essentially perfect on the inside, and that when we have problems in relationships, that it's everyone else's fault. And as a result, we never consider the ways that we need to change. And so we become trapped by bad habits that leave a trail of frustration and broken relationships behind us. The truth here, of course, is that none of us is perfect. We're all in need of grace and being further formed into the image of Christ. And so there are things in all of our lives that we need to work on and change. And recognizing that can seriously help us when we're engaged in conflict in the relationships that we have. Now, in these two examples, and they're just examples, but I'm trying to illustrate that our first piece of armor in fighting spiritual warfare is truth. Speak truth to yourself. Speak truth to others. Wrap yourself in truth. Challenge lies with truth. And when you do, that is spiritual warfare. Now, we don't have time to go through every piece of armor in detail, but let's just quickly list them for a moment. He talks about truth, righteousness, readiness with the gospel of peace, faith, salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which Paul tells us is the word of God. And at the very end, Paul also talks about praying in the Spirit. And all of these pieces of armor, even though they're not typically described as pieces of armor, but all of these things like salvation, truth, righteousness, the gospel, faith, you see them all over the New Testament. In one sense, if you were to just read the New Testament, you would see these things as just ordinary things that believers in Jesus do. Because Jesus is the truth, we speak truth. Because we've been declared righteous, we seek to live righteous lives. Because we've received the gospel of peace, we share the gospel of peace. Because we know that God is faithful, we have faith. Because Jesus is our Savior, we trust in his salvation. And so when Paul goes to explain how we engage in spiritual warfare, he just says, at a basic level, we do what Christians do. There's no special code words that Paul gives us and no magic items involved. We put on God's armor, we adopt the Christian life, we follow Jesus, and we stand. Now, before moving on to the conclusion for this sermon, I do want to highlight one more thing. In verse 18, Paul talks about prayer. He writes, "Pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. So if there was one very practical thing that I wanted you to take away from this sermon, it would be this. Pray like you're in a battle. Ask the Holy Spirit of God to change the hearts of people who are ensnared in racism. Pray that God would stretch out his hand and protect children and teens and adults from addictive things like drugs and pornography. Petition the Spirit of God to keep you and every Christian in this community safe from the schemes of the devil. Pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Deliver us from the evil one. Pray like you're in a battle. Put on God's battle gear, his truth, his righteousness, and faith. And stand against the evil one and the evil powers of darkness in this world. That's how we fight spiritual warfare. One of my main goals for this sermon this morning was to hopefully open our eyes to the spiritual wars going on all around us. Spiritual warfare is not only and all about casting out demons. Although that might be part of it, spiritual warfare is much broader. It is a battle against every spiritual power, whether they're personal powers like demons or impersonal powers like sin. And we are in the midst of these battles. The devil has schemes. Flaming arrows are flying in the lives of ourselves and those around us in the community. We're engaged in spiritual warfare, whether we like it or not. And so we need to put on God's armor. God's armor doesn't consist of things like crucifixes and holy water. Instead, it is about equipping ourselves with God's truth, salvation, and word. It is about praying all kinds of prayers and petitions that the Almighty Spirit of the living God would break the powers of darkness and shine his light in this world. And so with that in mind, I want to conclude with one final point. I've mentioned a few times that Ephesians 6 is at the end of a letter. And there's one more thing that I want to point out that Paul has mentioned earlier in the letter. At the very beginning, in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 19 to 21, Paul explains the power that God has worked in Jesus Christ in raising him from the dead. Here's what he says. He says, that power that God has worked in Jesus Christ, that power is the same as the mighty strength God exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one that is to come. And so the point I want to close on is this. Christ rules and Christ wins. There is no evil power on this earth that is above him. The devil, demons, and powers of sin might seem strong to us. And so spiritual warfare at first might sound scary. But the power and conqueror are on our side. Christ is so far above them that there is no comparison. And so, let me exhort you with the same exhortations that Paul gives his church. Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on God's battle gear. Resist the evil powers of this darkness. And in these evil days, stand. Let's pray. Father, this morning I want to pray the words of Paul for us from Ephesians 1, verses 17 to 21. May you, as the God and glorious Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we might know you better. I pray that the eyes of our hearts may be enlightened in order that we might know the hope to which you have called each one of us. May we know that your incomparably great power for us who believe. For it is the same power as the mighty strength you exerted when you raised Christ from the dead and seated him at your right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, every power and every dominion, and every and any name that is invoked, not only in this present age, but the one that is to come. Work these things in us for your glory and will, we pray. In the powerful name of Jesus, amen.
We're going to end with two songs, and I'm going to invite you to stand for both of them. This first song you may or may not know. It's a Casting Crowns song. So during this first song, if you do know it, please feel free to sing along with us. If you don't know it, this song is an invitation for you to spend time reflecting on what Nathan just spoke about and time reflecting on the words of this song, and then perhaps responding to the song in choosing to stand as courageous warriors. We were made to be courageous. We were made to lead the way. We could be the generation that finally breaks the chains. We were made to be courageous. We were made to be courageous. We were warriors on the front.
We were made to be courageous.
As you go this morning, I feel like it's fitting to end our service in a similar way to Paul ends his letter to the Ephesians. And so I'll say the same words again. Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty strength. Put on God's battle gear. Resist the evil powers of darkness. And in these evil days, as you go, stand. Amen.